Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Undergraduate Pilot Training graduation ceremony for Class 2312AU. I'm Lieutenant Colonel Michael Kissinger, Commander in the 33rd Flying Training Squadron, training students in the T-6 Texan.
And I'm Lieutenant Colonel Dan Hughes, Commander of the 71st Student Squadron.
Today's ceremony is a once-in-a-lifetime event. We encourage you to come forward and take pictures or videos when your loved one is presented an award or their wings. For your planning purposes, the wings are presented by rank and then alphabetical order.
Please stand for the entrance of the platform party and remain standing for the National Anthem of the United States, followed by the invocation given by Chaplain Prothero.
Good morning. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for today and this opportunity to celebrate this graduating class of pilots. We're inspired by their hard work, their commitment to excellence, and their dedication to serving our great nation. Lord, as these pilots begin their careers and move forward in training, we recognize the sacrifices that these brave airmen make for their country. We ask that your strength would uphold them, your hands of protection would cover them, and your peace would surround them. Lord, we also thank you for the instructors and support staff who invested so heavily for these students. Give them the grace to endure as they fulfill the mission that they have been called to. And thank you for all the family members and loved ones whose support and sacrifice has ultimately enabled each student here to succeed. I ask your continued blessing upon each graduate, each family member and loved one, our community advance, and our great nation. It's in your holy name that we pray, amen. Congratulations.
Thank you, Chaplain Prothero. Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated.
Today, 21 officers will receive their wings. On behalf of Colonel Charles Throckmorton IV, Commander, 71st Flying Training Wing, I'd like to welcome the family and friends of Class 2312AU, as well as several members of Team Vance, including squadron commanders, chiefs, first sergeants, spouses, and our ASRC and Amentum contractors.
We are honored to have the following guests from our civil and wing leadership here to support the graduates. Former Mayor of Enid, the Honorable George Pinkinen. The spouse of the commander, 71st Flying Training Wing, Ms. Brooke Throckmorton. The The Command Chief, 71st Flying Training Wing, Chief Master Sergeant Brandon Smith, his spouse Jessica, and Airman of the Month, Senior Airman Jalen Terry. The Vice Commander, 71st Flying Training Wing, Colonel Matthew Astroff. The Commander, 71st Operations Group, Colonel J.P. Pauls. The Commander, 71st Mission Support Group, Colonel Nikita Little. The Senior Enlisted Leader, 71st Mission Support Group, Chief Master Sergeant Zachary Plate. The Commander, 71st Medical Group, Colonel Rick Speakman and his spouse Melissa. The Senior Enlisted Leader, 71st Medical Group, Chief Master Sergeant Leslie Finley. The Director of Maintenance, 71st Flying Training Wing, Dr. Sherry Teague. Additionally, we are honored to have the following distinguished visitors as special guests of Class 2312AU. Please stand or wave your hand to be recognized. Colonel Michael Koblowski, United States Air Force, retired, and his spouse, Julie. Command Chief Master Sergeant Mark Massilli, United States Air Force, retired, and his spouse, Carolyn Miller.
We'd also like to give a warm welcome to our guest speaker, Lieutenant General Russell Mack, Deputy Commander, Air Combat Command, and the Commander, 71st Flying Training Wing, Colonel Charles Throckmorton IV. Ladies and gentlemen, Colonel Throckmorton.
All right, good morning, everybody. It's my privilege to welcome you to Vance Air Force Base and Eden, America. Today we have the incredible opportunity to pin wings on 21 new aviators as they recognize them graduating undergraduate pilot training in Class 2312. Mayor Pankaton, thank you for being here today and for your continued support of our military community and our families. To my fellow wing leaders, group and squadron commanders, chiefs, and to our government civilians and contract teammates, and to all of Team Vance, welcome to today's ceremony. Obviously, this would not be possible without your efforts and those of your airmen that you have put forth. I'd also like to welcome our distinguished visitors. In our presence today are members from several branches of the United States military, active, guard, reserve, and retired, and especially Colonel Retired and Chief Retired. Thank you both for being here. You and those that have served have paved the way for us to be here today, and you deserve special recognition. So I can get a round of applause. To the spouses, significant others, moms, dads, grandparents, brothers, sisters, children, extended family members, and friends of Class 2312, welcome to today's ceremony. You've provided our graduates the foundations, principles, moral compass, and a necessary work ethic to make it through this very demanding program. Thank you for sharing this great day with us. By way of introduction, Vance is one of the four bases in the United States Air Force whose primary mission is to conduct undergraduate pilot training, preparing and delivering highly qualified aviators for follow-on training in a variety of aircraft in our Air Force and those of our partner nations. In executing that mission, Vance Air Force Base has delivered over 35,000 world-class pilots since 1941, including such notables as General Richard Myers, the 15th Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the former Air Force Chief of Staff, General Ronald Fogelman, and the first female to command a space shuttle, Colonel Eileen Collins. Class 2312, make no mistake, you are graduating on sacred ground. Air Force heroes have walked these flight rooms and learned how to be pilots with the V and the N on their tail flash. I know you will follow in their footsteps and make us all Vance proud. Class 2312 and the seats next to you are fellow airmen and friends who have made a special bond in academics, maybe in the solo tank, track select, and soon assignment night, just to name a few. Although you'll be going in different directions from here, you will always hopefully have great memories of your pilot training experience and those sitting around you. I assure you, your memories will only get better with time and that 10% rule, so we can use that. So here we are. In a few moments, we'll hand out wings, but I ask you to remember that wearing wings is not a right. It is absolutely a privilege given and taken by those who precede you, and a privilege that will empower you to extend those to those that follow you. takes a total team effort to get our students to this day, and I'm very proud of the collective effort of Class 2312's graduation. We pour a ton of resources into these students. In fact, it is well over $1 million in each one of them to be the Air Force's next generation of pilots and leaders. However, it is not just money that gets them to this point. It's a joint effort of over 2,600 airmen, government civilians, and contract partners here at Team Vance. Whether supporting, generating, or executing the flying mission, all have played a vital role in the graduation of Class 2312. There are a few teams that I would like to recognize, three in particular. Although they are the least represented of the audience, the first one is our instructor pilots. These women, men and women have molded our graduates into the professional aviators that sit before you today, and they deserve our special thank you. The reason that there are very few of them here with us is because there is no break for them between classes. They are in the skies above us right now, continuing to produce the best pilots in the world. Please join me in a round of applause as we thank our instructor pilots. Second is our amazing team of professionals who maintain these aircraft. Pilots break them, maintainers fix them. It's a simple formula, but it happens quite frequently. We all know that. We have an incredible team of government civilians and contractors who are every bit an airman as those that are wearing the uniform today. We could not execute this mission without you. Thank you to Dr. Sherry Teague and her quality team, Mr. Pete Schneider and the Amentum team for ensuring our fleet of over 200 aircraft is ready to go every single day. Third and final are the fantastic men and women who make up the support and medical groups. COPS, services, finance, MPF, dental, and flight medicine, airmen, just to name a few. The wings that we are about to hand out would not be possible without their support. If I can get a round of applause for them as well. Lastly, I'd like to share with you two questions that you're inevitably going to get asked for the rest of your life. Those two questions are whenever two aviators meet. What class were you, and where did you go to pilot training? These are questions that we as aviators use to check credibility of each other, and I promise you that we will continue to do that. You should be proud that you are Class 2312. And even more importantly, you should be proud that you went to Vance Air Force Base. It doesn't get any more credible than that. Congratulations and welcome to the thin blue line. We're going to start that one over. Congratulations and welcome to the long blue line. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my honor and privilege to introduce our guest speaker today, Lieutenant General Russell Mack. General Mack is the Deputy Commander of Air Combat Command. And as deputy commander, he's responsible for organizing, training, equipping, and maintaining combat-ready air, space, cyber, and intelligence forces for rapid deployment and employment, while ensuring strategic air defense forces are ready to meet the challenges of peacetime air sovereignty and war defense. The command operates more than 1,300 aircraft, 34 wings, 19 bases, and more than 70 operating locations worldwide with 98,000 total force airmen and civilian personnel. General Mack entered the Air Force in 1988, receiving his commission from Officer Training School after graduating from the University of New Hampshire. He earned his pilot's wings at Euro-NATO Joint Pilot Training at Shepherd Air Force Base, and we won't hold you against you, sir. And General Mack has commanded at the training squadron at Laughlin Air Force Base and also commanded the best wing in the Air Force, our very own Vance Air Force Base, from 2010 to 2012. He's a command pilot with more than 3,600 hours, 400 of those in combat, flying the A-10, the F-15E, the F-16, the mighty T-37 Tweet, and the T-38, including time as the white right wing demonstration pilot for the United States Air Force Thunderbirds. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to introduce Lieutenant General Russell Mack.
All right. What an absolutely gorgeous day here in Enid, America. Mayor Pankinen, thank you so much for being here. Class 2312, congratulations. My hats are off to you. I graduated in class 9302 and from Shepherd Air Force Base. But I'm here to tell you that in my time in the United States Air Force, 35 plus years, I've actually been in Air Education and Training Command 7 of those years. I've been in the Pentagon 7 of those years, so it balances out. But in those 7 years in Air Education and Training Command, Colonel Throckmorton, I've seen and participated in over 125 graduations. So I've seen this experience from cradle to grave. And Thorke, I can tell you right now, you and Ms. Brooke, you guys are in for the best 2 years of your military career. But I'm here to tell you that it's not just because of this enterprise that you get to lead and to command. It's because of the civic leaders and the leadership here in Enid America that makes Enid, Oklahoma great. And you will find that they are the most humble, approachable, and exceptional community that I personally, in my 35 years in the United States military, have ever been associated with. So Mayor Hankinen, thank you so much for being here. It is an absolute privilege to be back. And for me personally, this community has touched me. In fact, we are in the Feitner Theater. And it's named after a woman by the name of Mary Feitner. And she was incredible. I know, George, you know her and everything else. And when I was here as the commander, she ran me ragged. No question about it. You know her. She was the Energizer Bunny. But she did more for this community and this base than any single individual I've ever known. In fact, we were close all the way up until the day that she had passed. She was basically a second mom to my spouse, Lynn. In fact, last night I had dinner with her son, Ray, and his wife, Kim, who was my honorary commander and a partner in the sky. And last night at dinner, it was absolutely fantastic to get connected with them. We've shared vacations together over the years and everything else. But it's all about the community. It's all about the people. And I'm here to tell you that Vance Air Force Base is what it is today because of the community that surrounds them. So, Mayor, I know on behalf of the entire civic leaders and the organization, thank you all so much for being here. And I know that all of our graduates and everybody in this room has seen a little bit of that and everything else. And I know you all are sticking around for just a touch longer, so congratulations on that. But get into the community. It's a humble place. So very personal for me to get back here and humbled by the opportunity. This is only the second time, I think, I've been back to Vance since I left here in command, mainly because of my jobs, but more importantly, though, because great leaders that come behind me or in front of me and everything else have paved the way. So what this is going to be all about is our graduates, after I say a few thank yous to the folks that actually got you here. We all know that it takes a village to get here, and I know that Thark touched base on every single entity of this mission and all the folks that provide this mission so that we can get these graduates where they are today. And, you know, I was very fortunate, because, like I said, I've seen over 125 of these graduations, but I've seen it from every single phase, if you will. And I don't think we do it anymore, but it used to be when I came to pilot training as a student about to start training, you actually sat in the back row. And as a class, you watched the class that you were going to replace graduate. You know, at that time, 52 weeks later, you were going to be right here in the front row, and you would get your wings, and you'd go from there. You know, and I remember sitting back there thinking, holy cow, man, I can't wait 52 weeks. This is going to be a thrill of a lifetime. And it was. And I would argue probably one of the best years of my military career. And I've done a whole lot of things in my military career. You know, from sitting in the back row to sitting in the front row to sitting as a family member out here, I can relate to what you're thinking about right now as you are humbled and honored to see what your member has done, your family member has done. But I'm here to tell you, folks, they wouldn't have gotten here without your love and support, period, dot, across the board. I've been an instructor. I was an ops officer at Shepherd Air Force Base. I was a squadron commander at Laughlin Air Force Base. I was a wing commander here. And with the exception of a couple of tweaks, the speeches that I just heard these gentlemen provide was pretty much what I recited 10 years ago. So change is hard, right? Change is hard. Accelerate, change, or lose, right? General Brown. Our future chief. But I want to start by saying thank you. And we'll start with, you know, the folks that made this happen, and that's our instructor pilots. You know, I know what it takes, you know, to sit in the back seat of an airplane for the first time and you give the controls to a pedestrian who may have never flown an airplane before in their entire lives, and you say, copy, you go. You got it. Right? You hang on for your left. No. But you know what? We recruit, and then we retain, and we train, you know, the best and the brightest, period, die. You know, so I know what it takes, you know, to sit in the back seat of an airplane, getting jerked all over the place and everything else as these fine aviators figure out how to fly. So my hats are off to the instructors that make this business happen. And you make it happen with it totally seamless to what goes on within the organization. So to our instructor pilots and our supervisors, thank you for molding and mentoring the next generation of combat aviators. So thank you so much for doing that. To all of the support entities that make this mission happen, whether you're a contract maintainer who maintains these 200 plus airplanes, thank goodness. I mean, these airplanes are older than I am, and I'm old, okay? But you know what? The Herculean work that you do to keep those airplanes airborne each and every day is nothing short of brilliant. So thank you so much for what you do from a maintenance perspective. From our mission support group that enable everything else that goes on. You know, there is not a function that you do in the United States Air Force or here at Vance Air Force Base that isn't touched by an airman that is residing in the mission support group. So thank you so much for what our mission support group does. To our medical team, we don't have readiness without our medical team. So thank you so much for keeping us fit and ready and mentally healthy to do the job that we do. To our ops group and the team that they provide each and every day, from an instructor pilot to a supervisor to these fine students right here in front of us, they have produced the world's finest. Don't ever forget it, ladies and gentlemen, we are the finest Air Force in the world, second to absolutely none. None. And it's not necessarily because of the Gucci equipment we get to fly and operate, because we do get to fly and operate some pretty Gucci equipment. It's because of our people. It's because of our people. No question about it. To our enlisted team and everything else, can't thank you enough. Airman Terry, thank you so much. I know you're coming up to speak after I'm done, so get ready for that. But I'll tell you what, you know, it's because of airmen like him that allow us to do our job each and every day. And, you know, I tell everybody, you know, I am very, very, very fortunate that I live in a gated community guarded by young men and women that carry weapons 24/7, 365 days a year. And I sleep well at night knowing that. And at the end of the day, I always say, when in doubt, thank an airman. Thank an airman. And I say that with a big A, right? Because it's not just about officers. It's not just about our enlisted personnel. It's about our civilians. It's about our contractors and everything else that make this mission happen. So when in doubt, every single day, thank an airman. Because that airman is what enables you to do the job that you have each and every day. So don't ever forget that from a graduate perspective, because it matters. It matters. You know, and to our graduates, you know, at the end of the day, and I mentioned to you when we were outside, you know, there's about 600,000 total force airmen that are in the United States Air Force. And the reason we have that many airmen, I mean, when I came to the United States Air Force, we were twice that. We were twice the size of that. You know, so we've downsized, right? We've increased mission, but we've downsized. But at the end of the day, it's happened because of the incredible people that have allowed us to do this. Like Colonel retired Cad Lebowski. I didn't see where you're at. Where are you? Colonel, where are you at? There he is, right over there. And Chief Massilli, where are you at? Right there in the middle. You know, and I know there are other guests here that are either military today or prior military and everything else. I want you to stand on my behalf, because I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for what you have provided me as the United States Air Force, and that you will continue to provide through those folks that you represent here today. So if I could get everybody that's either retired military, currently in the military, on active duty, Guard, Reserve, whatever, please stand. Thank you so much for your service, for your sacrifice. And what you have allowed me to do. I was telling the team, when I came to the United States Air Force 35 plus years ago, I wanted to be an airline pilot. Okay? I'm standing before you, not an airline pilot. Okay? And it's because of the people. And it's because of the mission. I fell in love with the passion known as the United States Air Force. And I'm proud to have served. And I will retire here in the near future. You know, but at the end of the day, I know, and I will sleep well at night knowing that great leaders sitting right here in front of me. You know, I probably have a four-star general somewhere right here in this audience, sitting right here in front of me, or maybe even a chief of staff in the United States Air Force, or Space Force, if you want to convert, right? But at the end of the day, it's great leaders that have paved the way for me, that allowed me to do what I do here today. So please thank those that have allowed us to do what we do. And then I want to give a real special shout out to moms, dads, family, and friends. Having sat in your seats, you know, patiently awaiting this knucklehead to stop speaking so we can get on with the wing presentations and everything else. But I know that these graduates, these 21 graduates, wouldn't be here today without the love and support of their family, whether it be moms, dads, brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, and what have you. So if I could get all of our family members to stand, This is the participation part. I talk, you guys stand. I can't thank you all enough for what you have done. Thank you so much. My hats are off to you. I can't thank you enough. And I can remember to this day when I graduated, way back in 1992, when I graduated, my mom and dad sat over here, stage left, and how proud they were when I was able to accomplish what I accomplished. But I wouldn't have been able to do it without them. And then the next special group I really want to thank, and that's our spouses. Okay? Because I'm here to tell you, you know, I have been married for 38 years this year. And, you know, got it. My wife's got a sense of humor. But I'm here to tell you that I wouldn't be here without their love and support, because they have followed me for 38 years, 35 plus years, 22 moves, and 4 different high schools for my son, 2 different high schools for my daughter, and a number of doctors, dentists, hairdressers, and everything else. So from a spouse perspective, I can tell you that's the hardest job in the United States military, is the job of our spouses. And so if I could get our spouses to stand up, come on now, this is that participation piece. I raise a few of you. Thank you so much for what you have done, but more importantly, what you will do and continue to do as you continue to shape the family and continue in this journey is known as the United States military. It's not always easy, I'm not gonna lie to you. I'm not gonna stand up here and tell you that everything is kumbaya, because it's not, okay? But it takes a very special family to do what we do, and a very resilient family. And I wouldn't have been able to do it without mine. If my family had said it's time to go in a different direction, knucklehead, I'd have went in a different direction. I'd have been an airline pilot. But I'm not, right? And so they've kept their sense of humor, and I can't thank them enough for that each and every day. So to your spouses and to the spouses, thank you so much for what you have provided and will provide it into the future with that. So for our graduates, congratulations. Congratulations. Like I told you outside, you know, roughly speaking, there's about 2.5% of those who wear the uniform of the United States Air Force today, total force, that wear the rated wings of an aviator. So if you think about that, that means there's 97.5% that are not aviators. But I'll tell you what, they are more, or just as, if not more, critical to the mission that you will provide than you could ever imagine. From that intel specialist that will provide you the intel that you need to prosecute a mission or a target or an enemy. From that space professional that's going to allow you the communications and everything else that you need to execute your mission. From that medical professional that's going to allow you to stay fit and ready and healthy to do the job that you need to do. From that maintainer that's going to allow you to jump in that jet, safely get into that jet, take that jet off with full confidence that you're going to return that jet just the way you found it and do the job each and every single day. You know, from every single enabler, from the force support folks and everything else that provide all of the admin that you need to do your job, that none of that will ever get done without that job. So without them doing their job, you're not going to do yours, okay? So don't ever forget that. You're in a small group. It's a fraternal order of aviators. But at the end of the day, it takes a village to get you there, and there's a whole lot of folks that are behind you that would do it. I would also tell you that we are very, very fortunate in the United States Air Force that we get to recruit the best and the brightest. I guarantee you the recruits sitting in front of me and the folks that we're about to put wings on are a heck of a lot more talented than I was when I came in some 35-plus years ago. You know, simply put, because technology has helped us get there, right, across the board. So I have no doubt in my military mind that for each and every single one of you, the 21 of you sitting here, I don't care if it's guard, if it's reserve, if it's active duty, there's probably 10, 20, or 30 deep that would give their left whatever to do what you guys have just had the opportunity to do. So don't ever forget that, all right? There are folks chomping at the bit to come in and do what we do. And that's a good problem to have, okay? Now, if we could get a little more recruitment across the board, we'd be pretty good. We're struggling a little bit right now, but I know we'll reach our goals from there, okay? So for the graduates, I just basically have 3 lessons learned for you and 1 must do that I have basically come to grips with over my 35.5 years in the military. First thing I would tell you, first lesson learned is this: know your jet, inside and out. Doesn't matter to me what jet you go to, whether, you know, obviously you start with either a T-1 or a T-38, And then from there, you're going to blossom into something else. I know we have our Guard and Reserve folks that are flying either 135s, F-15Cs, 130s, C-17s, all within the mix. And our active duty folks are going to go down that path as well, or an F-22 or an F-35 or an F-15E, F-15EX, maybe even the mighty A-10. You know, but at the end of the day, you need to know your jet. Just like you took the T-6-1 and you tore that thing up and you knew it inside and out, every single weapon system that you were having the privilege to fly, you need to know inside and out. Because I'm here to tell you, from a guy that stood here and flown over 400 hours of combat time, it will save your life. It will save your life. And in today's day and age of high technology platforms and everything else that we're flying, you need to know that jet inside and out. Okay? So first and foremost, know that jet. Second thing you need to do is you need to know your mission. You need to know the mission. I don't care what mission you're out there to fly. I don't care if you're doing OCA, DCA, airlift, airdrop, air refueling. It doesn't matter. Okay? You need to know your mission. Sorry, that's three-letter alphabet soup. Your graduates can tell you what all that meant later. But at the end of the day, it'd be close air support, you name it, okay, you need to know your mission inside and out. You know, because when bullets are shooting, and having been there, done that, yes, scared to death, not going to lie to you, okay, the only thing that you're going to have to fall back on is that training and that experience and everything else that has been provided to you as a foundation right here at Vance Air Force Base and the training that you're going to get going forward, okay? And why? Because you know your jet and you know your mission. You do those two things, whether you know it or not, it'll save your life, okay? It will save your life. Again, I came into the United States Air Force to be an airline pilot. Within 2 years of being in the United States Air Force, I was dropping bombs in Baghdad. Never in my wildest dreams would I have ever thought I was joining the United States Air Force to go drop bombs. Misconception on my part, right, because we all stood up and said, I do, to a constitution, right, support and defend against all enemies, foreign and domestic, right? I learned that day, you know, first combat mission, I learned that day, there was a bigger purpose than being an airline pilot. Okay, and that was passion for the United States Air Force. Okay, but I knew my jet inside and out, and I knew my mission inside and out. Okay, the third thing I would tell you that's probably just as important as the first two, know your enemy. Because your enemy knows you. Your enemy knows you. Okay, I have no doubt in my military mind there's a foreign government right now, today, knows that I'm standing here today giving this speech at Vance Air Force Base. Our enemy knows us probably better than we know ourselves. So you need to know your enemy. You need to get in the vault. You need to understand exactly what that enemy is. And I don't, you pick the enemy, okay? You pick the enemy. You know, if you actually see the capability and everything else that has grown over the past 20 years by the Chinese and what they have watched us do for the past 20 years in all of our operations in CENTCOM and everything else, it is unbelievable the capability they have accelerated because of us. Because they know that if we, as a coalition, because we will never fly, fight, and defend as a single service ever again, you will always have a joint partner, right? Whether it be the Guard, whether it be the Reserve, whether it be active duty, whether it be Navy, Marine Corps, Army, you name it. Not to include our foreign partners and everything else, you will do it as a coalition. And they know that. And they know, our enemy knows, that if we collectively pull together a force, whether it be NATO, whether it be our Asia-Pacific partners and everything else, we will kick anybody's tail. And I have no doubt we will do that, okay? But you need to know your enemy, inside and out. And at the same time, you need to know what your capabilities are. Not just the capability you're flying in, but you need to know the capability of your partners, whether it be your total force partners in the Guard and Reserve, and my hats are off to the Guard and Reserve, because I would tell you, in my experience, we have far utilized the Guard and Reserve than we were expected to do. We've asked a lot of our Guard and Reserve, and they've done it through volunteerism, mobilization, or whatever, but they've stepped up. So thank you to our Guard and Reserve partners for doing what you do and what you will continue to do. So you need to know your enemy, because if you're not, they'll hand you your lunch. That's just truth in advertising, okay? So big three lessons are know your jet, know your mission, know your enemy. You do that, you'll be a successful aviator. Okay, and then the one must do, and I'll be honest with you, I failed at this early on in my career, and that is find your balance. Find your balance. This is a marathon, not a sprint. Okay? And for those of you that are married or will be married or have family with you today, I've always said the same family you either started your Air Force career with or the family you picked up along the way is the same family I want to see you walk out the back door. Doesn't matter to me whether you stay 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 35 years or more. It doesn't really matter, but it matters that you've served. And it's served with a family. Because it is. It's a special family. So you got to find your balance. And whatever that balance is, whether it be your faith, whether it be your family, whether it be your friends, whether it be your fitness, whether it be your mental health, physical health, it doesn't matter. Find your balance. All work and no play is going to make Jimmy or Janie a pretty boring person. Okay? And I got consumed by my mission. Got consumed. And it challenged not just me, it challenged my family too. Okay? So at the end of the day, you got to find that balance, because if you want to make this a career, you need that balance, because that family is going to balance out you. All right? So don't get wrapped up in everything that you do without at the expense of your family. So know your jet, know your mission, know your enemy. More importantly, find your balance, because we need you for the long haul. Can't thank you enough for what you've done. Can't thank you enough for what you're about to do. I wish you all the best as you pin those wings on here in just a second. But you know what? Start Monday. Is it Monday? I don't know. Whenever you go either to the 38 Squadron or the T-1 Squadron, it's a new day, new jet. Shake or take or push to pass. Time to jump into that new aircraft, right? Know your jet. Know the mission. You don't need to know your enemy in that case. You'll learn that later, okay? That will come, all right? So congratulations to our graduates. More importantly, congratulations to the families. I'm humbled and honored to be back here in Enid, America. It's a special place to me, and it always will be a special place to me. But I can't thank you enough for allowing me the opportunity to speak to you today, because, again, the great leaders right here and those that we will continue to produce are going to run the greatest Air Force in the world, second to absolutely none. Thank you for your time today. God bless you all, and happy Friday.
Thank you, Lieutenant General Mack. Class 2312 would like to present you with a small token of their appreciation for being a part of this special occasion.
We will now recognize individuals who excelled in one or more phases of training. The new pilots competed for academic, leadership, and flying training awards, as well as the top wingman, distinguished graduate, and the coveted ATC Commander's Trophy. Each phase of training was carefully weighed, and only a slight margin separated the top performers. Colonel Speakman will now present the Academic Excellence Award to the pilot whose overall academic test averages exceeded those of their peers. The recipient of the academic award is Captain John M. Kadlubowski.
Colonel Little will now present the Leadership Award. The Leadership Award is presented to the officer who demonstrated outstanding leadership qualities and potential throughout this most rigorous and demanding military training program. The recipient of the Leadership Award is Captain Todd C. Landreth.
And now, Colonel Pauls will present the Flying Training Award. The Flying Training Award is presented to the pilot whose daily flying performance and check ride scores exceeded those of their peers. The recipient of the Flying Training Award is Captain John M. Kadlebowski.
Colonel Throckmorton will now present the Top Wingman Award. Selected by their peers, the Top Wingman Award is presented to the graduate who epitomizes the support and teamwork critical to being a great wingman. The recipient of the Top Wingman Award is Captain Frederick W. Meade.
Colonel Throckmorton will now present the Distinguished Graduate Awards. To be selected for this honor, a student must maintain an exceptionally high average in all phases of training and finish in the top 10% of the class. The first recipient of the Distinguished Graduate Award is Captain John M. Kadlebowski. The second recipient of the Distinguished Graduate Award is Second Lieutenant Julian L. Cortade.
Take a moment to go off script here. If you want to come forward and take pictures, please come forward and take pictures of your loved ones up here. We'll take time for it, so please come on forward. Father, the most prestigious trophy that Air Education Training Commander presents to a pilot training graduate is the ATC Commander's Trophy. This pilot excelled in both flying and academics and demonstrated the initiative and leadership qualities essential to the professional Air Force officer. Additionally, they personify the tenets of the Order of Dedalions, a group dedicated to military aviation, personal integrity, and patriotism. Lieutenant General Russell Mack will present the special award reserved for the officer who attained the highest overall rating throughout the entire program. And the winner of the ATC Commander's Trophy is Captain John M. Kadlebowski.
At this time, Colonel Throckmorton would like to recognize the instructor pilots selected by Class 2312AU who most embodied the Air Force core values during T-6 training and provided exceptional mentorship and instruction. Colonel Throckmorton will present the recipients with a plaque in recognition of their hard work. Receiving the award from the 33rd Flying Training Squadron, Major Ronald Todd, accepting on his behalf, Captain Jesse Calico. Also receiving an award from the 33rd, Captain Colton Fisher. This concludes the awards portion of the ceremony. And now the time that we've all been waiting for. Colonel Throckmorton will formally present the diplomas and pilot wings to our graduates. As they exit the stage, they'll receive a commemorative coin from a unique graduation number from the 71st Student Squadron, 1st Sergeant and Master Sergeant Kerry Wilson. The new pilots, families, and friends are invited to pin on the Air Force wings following the graduation ceremony.
Having completed the required course of training, the following officers from Class 2312 are awarded aeronautic ring of Air Force pilot. Captain Todd C. Landreth. Come on down, take pictures, come on down.
Captain Andrew J. Friedline.
Captain John M. Kadlebowski.
Captain Frederick W. Meade.
Captain Trenton J. Samaha.
First Lieutenant Isaac P. Coolidge.
First Lieutenant Cooper M. Hockley.
First Lieutenant Nathan N. Larivold.
First Lieutenant Matthew L. Reitinger.
Second Lieutenant Joseph R. Calandra.
Second Lieutenant Julian L. Cortade.
Second Lieutenant Alexander W. Garby.
Second Lieutenant Liam K. Gray.
Second Lieutenant Tyler A. Greenert.
Second Lieutenant Zachary R. Mandela.
Second Lieutenant Sarah R. Markowski.
Second Lieutenant Ty R. Miller.
Second Lieutenant Matthew C. Tague.
Second Lieutenant Daniel J. Valeri.
Second Lieutenant Dawson A. Young.
Second Lieutenant James J. Zawadny II. And now Colonel Throckmorton will present class 2312.